and said, "No, I'm not going in there." And what do you mean? And I said, "I'm not going in there. I don't agree with that." And they said, "Oh, well, it's voluntary." I said, "Well, good. I'm not doing it."
Yeah, but so that's like SeaWorld made you thumbprint. Right. At first, it was voluntary. Now it's mandatory. It's like dog training.
Passengers describe a terror attack and the arrest of a suspect who tried to blow up a plane as it landed at Metro Airport.
We heard a loud pop, then a bit of a smoke.
Sounded first like a balloon being popped.
All of a sudden, heard some screams, and flight attendants ran up and down the aisles. And
everything's crazy. People are screaming. There's fire on the plane.
So there was a lady shouting back, and she was saying, things like, "What are you doing? What are you doing?"
At that moment, I was sure I was going to die.
And we're learning tonight more about the suspect. Let's get to Fox News' Andrea Isom. She begins our team coverage. She is live at Metropolitan Airport. Andrea?
As the hours go on, you are right. We are learning more about the suspect, and quite frankly, the details are chilling. The man, the menace, 23-year-old Abdul Mudalla of Nigeria. Mudalla's despicable actions were all on Al-Qaeda's behalf. Sources telling Fox News his instructions were to blow up the plane over U.S. soil.
The intelligence community knew about Umar Farouk Abdulmutallab weeks ago and failed to spread word that would have put him on the no-fly list.
The father of the suspect in the Christmas incident warned U.S. officials in Africa about his son's extremist views.
That a report was prepared and it was sent on to the CIA in Langley, Virginia, CIA headquarters, but it was not disseminated to the wider intelligence community.
Obviously, when you have a father coming in and talking to the embassy about a son who's radicalized, gives the embassy the passport number, the first thing you would think is a very fast effort to see if the person's got a visa and suspend the visa.
One of the things you don't know about is the number of people that we have turned away because their name has been on the watch list or on the no-fly list.
Only my mom could, but not me and my dad, because both me and my dad are on the watch list.
Tough to believe, but 8 years later, we are still talking about connecting the dots at a failure to communicate.
Call for immediate reviews on how this guy got on the plane
and how he was able to get some explosives on the plane.
This is a controlled patsy.
Facts are facts. You can have your own opinions, but you can't have your own facts.
And we have this this same pattern that we've seen again and again. We have these individuals that have very limited mental equipment, but nevertheless, they're able to work miracles. In other words, they can do things that a normal person would never be able to do. You'd be arrested, you'd be questioned, you'd be searched, you'd be stopped in some way.
He gets out of countries, he's disheveled, looks like he's drugged, stumbling around. I mean, this is classic.
He doesn't get on any serious list of for scrutiny or special search. And then we have this famous story of the well-dressed Indian who accompanies him.
I saw two men, and they caught my eye because they seemed to be an odd pair. One was what I would describe as a poor-looking black teenager around 16 or 17, and the other man, a age 50-ish, wealthy-looking Indian man, and I was just wondering why they were together. Kind of strange. And I watched them approach what I would call the ticket agent, the final person that checks your boarding pass before you get on the plane.
He gets from one plane to another thanks to this patsy minder, a patsy chaperone or patsy monitor.
The only person that spoke was the Indian man. And what he said was, this man needs to board the plane, but he doesn't have a passport. And the ticket agent responded, "Well, if he doesn't have a passport, you can't get on the plane." To which the Indian man responded back, "He's from Sudan. We do this all the time." And the ticket agent said, "Well, then you'll have to go and talk to my manager." And she directed them down a hallway. And that was the last time that I saw the Indian man. Mm-hmm. And the black man I didn't see again until he tried to blow up our plane.
Then I'd be interested to see, is there a passport? Won't the FBI please show us a passport? If there is one.
They won't release the videos from Amsterdam. I mean, this is suspicious.
Oh, yes. I think it's beyond suspicious. It's a clear case of a patsy. So he's a controlled asset. And, of course, it's not a matter of failure to connect the dots. We're hearing all about the unconnected dots. No, this is the desired outcome. Let me just point out a couple of other things here. We're told that this alleged bomber, knicker bomber, whatever they call him, he was in contact with this character, Awlaki, in Yemen. And, of course, this Awlaki, I call him Awlaki the CIA lackey. Awlaki the lackey, and remember, he's a CIA lackey. He's a double agent, a triple agent, if you want. He is used as a kind of beacon to recruit patsies across the world, and they can always sheep-dip somebody like Major Hassan. If they want to say, you're linked to Al-Qaeda, they just have you exchange a few emails with this Awlaki, and that's what he's good for, right? He goes back to 9/11 in Hani Hanjour. So this guy is he's a U.S. agent under whatever layers of garb that he's got. The other thing is, how was this young patsy Omar Farouk Mutallab? How was he radicalized? And I think we're getting some pretty good indications that it's this Brixton Mosque, Finsbury Mosque, Axis in London, the school for patsies, the British patsies.
Which, by the way, 6 months ago, I remember it, you predicted we'd see plane bombings out of that mosque.
This is not so hard to do. Remember, Richard Reed, mentally retarded vagrant who was sleeping on the floor of Brixton Mosque, I think, he was given the same PETN explosive by somebody. So that's what this Omar Farouk was given then, allegedly, once again, in Yemen. So you can see it all fits together, and it all comes from these same places.
There are reports today that the Christmas Day body bomber met with an American-born radical cleric, Anwar al-Awlaki. He's believed to be living in Yemen, al-Awlaki is. He's not only been linked to al-Qaeda in the past, but he reportedly exchanged emails with the suspected Fort Hood shooter, Nadal Hassan, before that shooting massacre in Texas.
I would also point out that the security company at Schiphol Airport is ICTS, which is an Israeli-owned firm. They were the same firm that allowed Richard Reed, the shoe bomber, to board the flight, the American Airlines flight to Miami. Same explosive material was found in his shoes as was found in Mr. Mutallab's underwear. They ignored the threats on purpose. Obviously, this, we had a lot of people sitting at home over the Christmas holidays, families gathered around the television set. Another terror attack, huge problems for travel now.
When we talk about screenings at the airport and other protective mechanisms along the way, what should we be doing that clearly we're not?
The scanning machines that we currently are beginning to deploy in the U.S. that would give us the ability to see what someone has concealed underneath their clothing.
These body scanners are the key with these different psychological syndromes where people serve the abuser.
Yeah, because that's where you have to get in, as to where this is going. It's not fun. It's degradation. It's the dehumanization of the individual. So really, what they're telling you is not only do you not own your body, you own nothing. You don't even own the patterns to your own genes. They're telling you you're a piece of property.
What do they do when you first come into a prison? They strip you and do a medical exam to humiliate you.
They hose you down in front of other prisoners and they laugh at you, make jokes about you.
When Aaron went through, it was even worse because I was behind him.
Yeah, I went through. He told me to go through the scanner and I said no. He said, why aren't you going to do it? I said, it violates my privacy. And this is what happened. This guy got scared. This guy was physically bigger than me. He was athletic. He started shaking when I said no. You think it doesn't matter to
tell because it's a delusional world. He thought he found a real terrorist.
Yeah. He was shaking, visibly shaking, when I said no. And he tried to trick me to go through it again and told me they were going to body wand me, which they ended up doing. And then he tells me, oh, because I don't like it because it violates my Fourth Amendment, I read too much. Oh, you're one of those who reads too much.
And you said he put his hands on you.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah, he grabbed
me. When I said no, he started shaking. He didn't know what to do. And then his first flinch reaction was to grab my arm and try to pull me through the scanner. It was absolutely crazy. And you got women apologizing to the agents. I'm so sorry. I forgot my mascara and my lipstick. And the Fourth Amendment says if you're going to search, you're not only going to have a warrant, you're going to say specifically what you're looking for.
But
it's not specific. It's liquids. It's lipstick. It could be shoes. It could be...
Breaking the will of the people. The real purpose of body scanners. And you scroll down, it shows the Nazis and others strip searching women in World War II.
I tell you what I would do personally. I would just take photographs of all the mass graves of World War II and the Soviet Union, of all the naked bodies and having placards of that. And
genius!
And saying we're not going to end up like this. No, thank you.
Great idea, pointing out that they always strip you down before they kill you. I mean, it's a real act of submission. Do you agree with me that this, telling everyone you will be naked body scanned, is a key point in our conditioning and we must resist it?
Oh, absolutely, absolutely. It's an ongoing process of the personalization, dehumanization, and getting the public to accept the fact they're nothing but cattle.
Once you're on the plane, you're coming into Detroit, what happens next?
The pilot comes on the speaker, and he says we have 10 minutes to landing. Flight crew, take your seats and buckle up. A flight attendant walks by my seat, mumbling to herself, something smells like smoke. I looked up. I'm in row 27. I could see smoke coming from row 19, eight rows up. It wasn't a lot of smoke at that time, and it looked like it was coming from